have to change it. It may be our attitude, it may be our behavior, it may be our style, it may be our skill that we need to change. So for that reason, we realize that people need to be equipped for them to move to another level. You cannot, someone was saying foolishness is doing the same thing the same old way, expecting different results. So I was in business, I am in business, I once failed several times. But to the point that I started to learn out what is it that I'm missing. So for that reason, I want to welcome the chairman of Zimbabwe Global Entrepreneurship, who are the organizers of this meeting, to come and introduce our guests tonight, and they will give us a background about Zimbabwe Entrepreneurship. Then we will move on. I want to welcome Mr. Paul Mapinin, who is the chairman for Zimbabwe Global Entrepreneurship.
You have no idea what many then there's some people who make a future to happen. And that's what I pray tonight, that you are like that. So the brain has changed over time. And so, because I want to say, to start with thinking, I teach renewing the mind. My background, just been doubling into everything. But when I started doing neuroscience and understanding more about the brain, I realized this is my assignment. And so I want to talk about the brain from an area of understanding what's going on with my brain. Now, in reality, the brain is what the mind does. The mind and the brain are not the same thing. They're two different things. So what the mind does is what we see in the brain. If you were going into a hospital to be, you have a problem, you have a tumor in your brain or whatever, and doctors are coming, neuroscientists are working with you in there, they can see with MRIs thoughts. Now we now know that thoughts are things. They actually occupy what we call cortical real estate. So they're in there. They're things. They don't go anywhere. In your life, everything that has happened from as an early child until now didn't go anywhere. It doesn't disappear. I used to think if you want to change things in your mind, it's like getting a cup that's got some stuff in there and you want to change it and make it clean. Just put it on a faucet, open the water, run clean water until the whole thing is clean. Well, it doesn't work like that. In fact, now we know Dr. Deutsch from Canada, a psychoanalyst, came up with a great theory that's now teaching us that there is what they call competitive neuroplasticity. In other words, brains, whatever is in your brain stays there and does not go anywhere. It fights just to remain there. This is why you still remember all the stupid things you did. They didn't go away. And anytime you try to do something new, those things in your memory that you shouldn't be thinking when you're trying to make a new step to change, they jump up and they come to the front and they remind you you're the first one told by that stuff that, oh, look, you did this before. Don't be stupid now. You know how it happens. You start this and halfway, you know, everybody seen people that say, I started a business and I quit, then I started that week, and then I enrolled everything and then I quit. And so they are now quitters who just quit all the time. Why? They're now in an automatic belief of who they are. And what they believe is this thing that's in their brain is not going away. And so the question becomes, how do you change that? Because that's where change begins. Now when you come in a place like this and we talk about global things and all those big things that we see on television and so forth, but then after you're by yourself, you're going, that's impossible to do. I mean, I know he was talking, but you know, I mean, that's impossible to do. I have no idea what New York looks like, or Atlanta looks like, or Paris looks like, and I have no idea what the Chinese are doing around here. You know, so the whole thing becomes just too far away from you when you're alone, which means in order for the things to happen, the changes to happen inside. We begin with you inside. When you are changed from inside, then you are prepared to create your own environment. It is the environment that you create that you can change. And it is the environment, now I tell people this very lovingly, and I tell them, I say, you know, you're not supposed to win in life. You're supposed to dominate. I know you didn't hear me. You're not supposed to win in life. You're supposed to dominate life. Period. Because when we say dominating, I'm saying you have an opportunity every day to make things that are contrary to where you're going. None of us will have things just flow nicely. No. If you are expecting a life and things that have no challenges, you are in for a rude awakening. Life doesn't believe in that. Both of us receive the same thing, blessing and challenges. I don't call them problems, I say challenges. You know, then a challenge comes and you've got to deal with it. Now, here's what we want to do tonight. We want to have a paradigm shift. And the paradigm shift is, how do I see problems? Problems are good for you. Well, I'm alone now. Yeah. Problems are good for you. They're very good. See? If you have a life without problems, you stop thinking. You stop creativity. You stop fighting. You wake up late. Nothing driving you in your heart to go to the next level. Everything about you ceases. You're just now average. The world is full of averages. Full of them. But our goal tonight is to pull out the greatness within you. See? Now you know, I'll do this anytime. And I'll talk to young people like this, like I'm talking to millions. And I'll never, you can't stop me. I mean, because the next president of this country could be sitting here. And I don't know it yet. And I've never been here before. All I know is, somewhere in life, you will break through. Bam! And everybody's wondering, oh, I know him. I know him. You know, do you know that your friends will never see change in you? Yeah. Which makes me give you a very nice nugget tonight. If your friend is exactly like you, one of you is unnecessary. You don't need a friend like you. Your friend is broke, and you're broke. No. That's a wrong friend. See? Because it's going to be raining outside. And you're going to walk, and he's walking, and he's my friend. You're walking in the rain. No, I don't want a friend like that. I want a friend with a car. When it's raining, he says, where you going? I tell him, he says, okay, come, let's go. Yeah, he's a good friend. I want to have a friend that I call on the other side of the world. I say, Kenny, I just made $10,000 right now. Like, yeah. What's going on? I said, oh, no, I'll tell you later. Just please, $10,000 right now. Okay, where do I send it? This is my name. And I have it. That's a good friend. Huh? Yes. So, the first step to change. You change your friends. Because if you've got people around you that don't know where you're going, they won't go with you where you want to go. And they will be the brakes every time you try to make a change. Every time you try to make a change. They're the ones that will tell you, you know, so-and-so tried to do what you're doing, and they never did it. So I want to show you quickly, let's do some little biology here. Then we will get back into the brain, into the lesson. So let's talk about biology a little bit. The brain can be divided into many areas depending on what you want to learn about it. So I'm going to do the basic one, the basic thing. When you see the picture of your brain, the cross-section of it, it gives you the evolution of the brain. The evolution of the brain. Now, the Project Blue brain, they are computer brain that will think like a human being. So they're working. They've been doing this for the last 10 years. They have spent almost $30 billion, and all they've done is only to work on a very small part of the brain to make that to work like a brain. And again, it's still difficult to do it. See? So you have no idea what's between your ears, right? That science up to now is struggling to recreate your brain to the level that you came already designed with it. Which means if you are not doing the impossible, it's not God's fault. That is somebody's fault. You, the owner of the brain. You have no idea how expensive you are that you're carrying right now. So the brain has evolved over 11 billion years. Some say 13 billion years. Now, all of you church people, don't get angry with me. I mean, it's science and it's correct. Right? Yeah. I didn't say how your brain, the human brain, was 11 billion. I said the brain is a different thing altogether. Right? So, let's try and get some of you to church a little bit. Now, so that I have friends. scripture would say, God, the third Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, and there was the waters, and he separated them from those up and beneath, and then he said to the waters, that way, let them be teamed up with life. So the first life was things in the water, right? And those things in the water had a kind of a brain with them. That brain was just very small. It was what we call the reptilian complex. That brain. It was just as small. Its job was survival. You survive, you make kids. You survive, you eat, you make kids. That's all they did. That was their brain. See? But the problem with it is survival is not the same thing as success. So if you are in a survival mode all the time, because things in Zima are, you believe, and so now you're walking in a survival mode, and I come here and I tell you, forget you. There ain't nothing like Zimbabwe heart. It's just a situation for something in you to get up and to turn things around. You see, I get excited. I get it. When I see problems, I'm happy. Yeah, I know I'm alone now. But who cares? I'm with you. since I came all the way. I mean, I came all the way from the U.S., came all the way. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to tell you these things, and I leave. One of these days I'll see you. My goal tonight is to make you uncomfortable with yourself. And my goal tonight is to make you not like yourself. My goal tonight is to make you not feel that you have arrived. When I see people that worry about how much money they have, I know their problem. You see, if you put a big fish in a small pond, it thinks it's something. Until you move it to a bigger ocean, and then it finds whales there. Huge things. I was telling some kids this afternoon. We went out in an MBA class, and Mr. Warren Buffett came to speak to us. Anybody heard about Warren Buffett before? Warren Buffett? Warren? Thank you. No. And you're all business people and you don't know Warren Buffett? What the hell is that? He's the richest guy. Come on, folks. I mean, that's where you want to go, isn't it? So you got to know the people who are out there in front. Now you got to create some kind of a role model of where you want to go. And for me, Warren is a pretty good guy. So he comes in this big auditorium, and they give him a microphone, and he's about to talk to us. And Warren starts to test the microphone. And he says, 1 million, 2 million, 2 million, 3 million, 3 million. 3 million. Now, I realized something. There's something about this billionaire thinking. They don't go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No. Now, I'm looking at you here tonight, and I'm thinking there's a way to think to be a millionaire. That's right. There's a way you think like a millionaire. And when you think in a millionaire way, things change. You gotta like me tonight. I don't care what you say. Because tonight, I have decided to face all your thinking about yourself that's been putting you down. And I've decided to come straight face to face with you. And I'll tell you wonderful words like stop being stupid. Right? Yes, until you like me. See, because, no. Whoa. If you hate rich people, don't worry, you won't be one of us. That's right. I put that one in there. Yeah. You cannot be what you hate. You cannot attract what you hate. So when I see a rich person, I call them my friends even if they don't like me. See, we pastors are known for begging, you see. So when we come, this, how much do you want for a friend, Riff? No, I don't want your money. I'm cool. Yeah, really cool. in loving God. But it was very hard. That's right. Then the Lord blessed me. I found out, ooh, now I can actually pray for you. All the time I told you I'll remember you in prayer, I couldn't. I was so much problems over me, but by the time I got to pray, who are you for me to remember you at that time? I had my own problems. So if a poor pastor changes his life quickly, he's not praying for you at all. Everything he told you and promised you is not happening. He has too much on his plate. Too much on his plate. Too much. I can tell you a lot of biblical stories of how that guy who the widow came to the prophet says, you know, my husband loved God and he served and then he died and he left us in debt and then he says, and the debtors are coming to take my children. And then the man of God says, what do you have in the house? He says, no, nothing but a jar of oil. He says, oh, go borrow some big containers. Don't borrow a few, borrow a lot of them. Take them to the house, shut the door, you and your children. Begin pouring that oil. Huh? I like a life like that, that God can give me direct steps to do things and get out of debt. That's right. That's why for me, I asked God, I said, Father, how do I handle business and what I do in my beliefs? He says, no, you're making a mistake. They're one thing. Hold your business as a spiritual thing and your spiritual thing as a business. I said, oh, really? How does it work? And from that moment, I began to understand, no matter what I'm doing, it's holy. No matter where I am. So I don't do underhand. I don't do deals on the corner. I don't do any of that foolishness. Everything I do is holy. Right now. One wonderful politician wanted me to pray for them, but they wanted to deal with me, see? I said, okay, fine. Let's not do the deal. He said, why? I said, because you're going to be sick one day. And when you're sick, you die because I'm there. You can't ask me for prayer after we did a deal. So let me not be into deals with you. So I can be the one to pray for you to leave. Glory to God. Now, so what we're dealing with is the praying itself. So we now know that the first life was those little things. And all they had was a survival brain. Then the Bible says in verse 5 and 6 there, and it says, then God created animals that were to creep upon the ground and everything. So there was another generation of creation, a different day, right? And those were mammals and everything we can think of, all these dinosaurs and everything. What were they doing? They were different. They had an empathy, a brain that was different. That brain was called the limbic system, right above the old one. They grew that other brain. It's the middle brain, right? And that brain had a job. Its job was a little different. It understood that when I give birth to something, I nurture it. And so it was giving birth to things, and it was nurturing them. Giving birth to things and nurturing them. And so it was growing. So mammals were the first one to allow the child to have milk. Grow from me, they said. And then they defended each other and protected. They lived in communities. That brain allowed them to be connected. So there was now connectivity in the creation. All of that was happening. But then the last part was Genesis, the same part, book, the last, verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image. The last creation, man was created. And when man was created, he was given another brain on top of the other brains. And that brain is the youngest brain. We call it the neocortex. The one thing that's folded, that thing. Yeah, its job is for thinking, reasoning, planning, forecasting, and all those things. That's what that one does. Right? So we talked of three brains. The first one was survival. So your brain, by default, wants to protect you. Now, why is it that when you make a decision to do something, right now, if you don't do it, 10 minutes later, your brain talks you out of it. And you don't do it. You told yourself, I'm going to enroll to school. And you did, you've never done it. But quitting is easy. Anything that's really serious that makes a change, your brain talks you out of it. You know how that happens? The old reptilian complex begins to talk. So he tells you, be careful now, be careful. That's a pastor over there, you take your money, be careful. And you don't do what it needs to do to change your life, right? Faith changes things. Changes things. Now, faith works in business. Well, just, I mean, look, anybody, never get into business if you don't have faith. You know, you gotta believe that what I'm doing will work. And the first thing you need to believe, you gotta believe in yourself that you can do this. I saw myself talking like this years ago, and I knew I was gonna do this worldwide. Before I came here this afternoon, I was doing this seminar in South Africa, throughout the whole country, radio-wise. Bam! So I was speaking to the whole of South Africa before I came here. Yeah? And I keep doing this everywhere I go. I believe I've got a message with mediocrity and to deal with excuses and to tell you, forget you, it's time you get up. You get up. All people come around and say, things are so hard. It's very, money is so difficult. You go to the bank, $50, all you get. And all that rap we talk about, you know? But do you know, there are people in Zim, they don't even understand what you're saying. They have no idea. They don't even go to the bank for the $50. No. If you talk about lack and poverty to them, they'll just go, yeah, and they walk away. See? Right here in Zim. They are not part of your problem. And they don't even want to think the way you think. No. You have got a very strong reptilian complex. You have major problems. And you are so in the autopilot when it comes to your excuses. Why it cannot be done. Every opportunity you're given, you walk out of it. I don't have money. I don't have this. I don't have that. Now, if I came here and I gave you opportunities, and then I said, but to get it, you got to pay $500 to do this. All of you will go home without taking it. All of you will leave this place and go without an opportunity. And if that $500 probably was going to change your life to, for the first time, you see 5,000 in your life. And then you go, 50,000. Then you go, oh, yeah. You know one thing I liked about Sim some years ago? We had this currency that was going so, and we had to count by billions, then we went to trillions. It made all of us great mathematicians. Yeah, one thing at least we could talk about trillions in Zim. For sure. It was one of the best things we did. We actually understood what a trillion is. Zim had trillionaires. Absolutely. I don't care whether it meant nothing or not. At least mentally, we were thinking trillions, which was a pretty cool thing. See? Yeah. Now, it shouldn't be hard for us to reconnect. The figures to reconnect, you know, the billions. We should be finding it easy, from Zim at least. You know, when a billionaire, you got a billion years out of it. Yeah, I can trust with that. So easy, from Zim. Ah, let me tell you today, what changes a people is not the change itself. It is the willingness to change. You will never change without the willingness to change. You can have me or any other person you know who's wonderful, and they will tell you everything about change. You will never change until there is willingness to change. Now, willingness to change is a step before the change itself. This is why when you hear someone talking about change to you, it's so hard for you to do. You know why? Because there's no willingness to change inside you. But if I came in this group and someone in this group is wondering, how do I change? I want to change. Willingness to change. You know, one part of the scripture says when this, it's not a scripture, it's mine from here. Yeah? When a student is ready, the teacher shows up. That's right. Some of you in here that are listening to this stuff, because somehow, you know, It has been made possible for me to be here. I had no plans to be in Zin today, to tell you the truth. Eh? Yeah, today I was supposed to be defending another thesis. Today. But God told me, no, you're going to Zin. So I called those people, I said, you can wait that stuff. I have to go to Zin. I have to. Do you have to? Do you know, Professor, what is flying in, what from what, when some? I said, I don't care, let them not cancel their trips, I am going to Zin. That's right. And God had you in mind. And that's why I'm here. So we didn't meet accidentally. Now, that means you don't have to like me. You just have to listen and take it. And then go against the grain and do what you hate to do. Which is to tell yourself, I don't have it together yet. There's a long way for me to go. And I need to do the right thing. Right? So, you're going to learn a secret today. And the first one is, learn to talk to your brain. One, you have a brain. The brain doesn't have you. Don't go around and say, I don't know, I just see myself thinking. And I think about that, then I think about that. No, the brain doesn't have you. You need to tell that brain, shh, stop it. I'm thinking now. And then you do the proper thinking. Why? Why do you need to know about this? Because your brain is neither intelligent nor stupid. It's just a brain. And it is designed to do certain things, and that's what it does. Every day of your life, your brain is monitoring. Monitoring. The thing that you think most, the brain interprets as important. So if problems are your major things, the brain interprets as important. So when you go to sleep, the brain gets into its job. The brain never sleeps. It falls into what we call default mode. And in the default mode, it's busy, it's sorting out things, sorting out things, sorting out things. And what is it doing? It's sorting them by the order of their importance. And all of a sudden the brain thinks, this is what she was thinking a lot. She thought about John for the whole day. John must be important. Then the brain pushes John in the front. You wake up in the morning, John is all you think about. And then you wonder, why can't I change life? Well, what part of life are you really thinking? Absolutely nothing. Which brings me to my very important statement. I don't want you to ever forget this one. No one succeeds accidentally. No. That means prosperity is by purpose or by design. You are going to design prosperity, then you go after it.
Yeah.
I wasn't born in America. No. I was born in Old Mutare Hospital. That's right. I wasn't born with a golden spoon in my mouth. No. And I was never been connected with the powerful. No. I am not here because I'm known by someone. No. I'm just busy going with God the way He wants me to go. And I'm pretty cool. The next time, as God blesses and things are moving, I've made one clear thing in my mind, and I told myself, you know what? I'm traveling too much. I just want my own jet. That's right. So I'm thinking it, and I'm seeing it, and I'm thinking it. I sleep with it. I wake up with it. I see it. I see it. I see that Bombardier. I see it. Time. See, I leave Johannesburg, we land in Sao Paulo. One hope. From Sao Paulo, Dallas. One hope. Yeah. It's got a beautiful bedroom at the back where my wife can sleep if she wants to. That's right. And we do the whole work. Pretty cool. Why? I found that God is a good, good, good God. And that I am loved by Him. And that's who I am. See? You know that song? Yeah, it's a good, good God. See? So, because if you are going to ask things from a God whom you are not so sure if He is good or not, then you're wasting time. I figured that out. And I saw Him to be so good. And so I told Him I'm doing business. He was so good. Then I told Him I want the yada yada. He said, yeah, yeah, yeah. He said, oh, do you want more? I said, how does more look like? Huh? I can never even finish God. Wow. And so I made up my mind. I said, I'm going to get into partnership with God and we get this thing done. That's right. I'm the most peaceful guy around here. Very peaceful. I don't toss in the night. I don't wake up. I don't worry about bills. No. No, 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 no. No. I don't have nightmares. No, I go to bed and I sleep. And when I wake up in the morning, because my mind is too much thinking about God, I wake up with songs. And sometimes I go to bed with my computer here is full of videos, worship videos, all kinds of great musicians that worship God. Full, yeah. So I just let it play and low and the whole night. And because my subconscious doesn't sleep. So he's picking all that music while I'm fast asleep. So I wake up with a song and I'm worshiping God, ready to go. Then by the time the problem comes, I don't even know it. Now I have another habit. I run. I like running. You know, running. Because I'm only halfway in my life. I'm now 62 years old. That means, because I'm shooting to go to 120. You know, by 120 then I check out. But right now, I still got a long way to go. So I gotta have a healthy body. And so I asked her, she said that you got some supplements and that thing. And I said, okay, good. I'm gonna check that out. So, but I like running. When I sleep, I put my running shoes on the door. And when I'm waking up in the morning and I come out of the shower, I'm going straight to the shoes on the door and out to run. Now, there's a reason for that. If I'm solving a business deal that someone came on top and I was at the bottom and I lost, I need to run. While I'm running, my body begins, my lower brain begins to manage my running because it's for survival, remember? So it's managing, or there's a whole 10 left and so forth. That's what my lower brain is doing. It frees up my thinking brain. So now my thinking brain is free and I kick into higher level of solving problems. So while I'm running, I can see a deal and I can see where I missed it. And I can begin, oh, that's where they got me. That's where they got me. I see, I need to call them. I need to call them. Ah. And then when I call and say, you know that deal, you forgot to add ABC. Oh, they come almost like they fall down because did you ask somebody? I said, yeah, I did. I asked my higher brain to show me what's going on. You are supposed to be an active creature. That's how you were created. And if you are engaged in doing things physically, it releases you, even just washing dishes, that takes your lower brain to do it and frees the higher one. When the higher one is free, that's no time for John. No! Now you solve the problems. John is out of the window at that time. Right? You can actually tell your brain John is the problem, and you put him on the side. Right? And you begin to say, what I'm going to do, I'm changing things. There are two kinds of people. those that make change and those that have change happen. To them, it's forced on them. If you're not proactive about life, life won't give you a chance. It doesn't. It will come after you. Now, do you know, I started talking of competitive neuroplasticity at the beginning, that there are thoughts in you that are not going anywhere, that are sitting in there, that are completely controlling every move in your life. Remember? Yeah. Let me tell you how beautiful the brain is. The brain compensates for that. Then it builds new neurons and places new thoughts. Now, it doesn't stop there. These old brains that are in there, they also are tuned to, they're wired together. So Dobbs said, neurons that fire together are wired together. You don't remember one thing, you remember things, events. So you can remember when you were roasting the beef, how it smelled, the music that was playing. It's an event that you remember, not the meat in the pan. The whole thing that was up. If the child was crying, you can, the whole thing comes in your brain. So those, they all fire together to create an event. This is why it's hard for you to change an event in your life. Because once it happens, you can remember, you know, if it was something that you did not want to do, but somebody forced you to do it, and when you did it, you still feel so bad after a long time, it's because everything is connected and connected and connected and connected. So you're overwired, wired to this and wired to that and wired to that. And so everything that fires together remains together. What's your goal there? Your goal is to create new things to fire together. Now, while I'm there, let me just make sure I push this in. We all have what we call a belief window. A belief window is the way we believe what we believe in our lives. We see things through that window. If anything comes from this side or that side, we don't take it. And so what we take, we have already agreed that is true. The only problem with a belief window is everything you believed 10 years ago, right now, it's now false, most of it. It has changed. For example, if I say, let's have an exercise, pull out a piece of paper, and write down things that 10 years ago, they were true to you. You would write things like, oh, I believed in my political party, but now I changed. Would you be true? If I tell you, the party is great, you go, no, not to me. But before you were okay with it, what happened? The belief window changed. The belief window changed. I used to be in a wonderful church, and I mean, we were like completely sold out. But after a while, things happened in my life that just began to change. And I grew that. And then someone saw me and said, are you still one of us? I said, not quite, but I love Jesus. And then they're going, well, you know what I mean, the way we do it? I say, no, I ain't doing it that way anymore. Because God has shown himself to be greater than before. See, God opened doors for me. And I began to be around great people. I used to travel with Paul Roberts in his private jet throughout the United States. I mean, I used to be big people. You know, I've been with Kenneth and everybody. I mean, so I've seen greatness outside my beliefs. I used to believe me and our church were the biggest thing. Then I saw some big things that our church could even get close to. And I went, oh, so yeah, God is bigger than our church. Oh, my goodness, he's also out there. And I went, then I began to see, oh, yeah, God is so big. So big. So I changed my mind. I pray that you're going to keep on growing bigger and bigger. And things that you've been believing that have been keeping you in a certain bondage, you're going to outgrow them. And when you do, the next time you meet those things, they won't force you to bow anymore. You will say, I think I know God. So one day I was with Paul Roberts and I asked him, Okay, I left Africa because Miles Monroe picked me up from Africa. Yes, it's about 30 years. So I left Africa. Now, here's a good story. It's a good story. Before he died, he flew to South Africa. Then he found me and my wife there. And he said, God sent me to come here to see you. I said, oh, what's going on? He said, I need to put the anointing on my life for the third world on your life. I said, really? He said, yes. So on that service, he called all these white big people that were there, and then he laid his hands on us. And his father, I bestow on you the third world anointing. And then he left. 3 weeks later, he was in heaven. From that moment on, I knew that I was on a race with time. And that's why I am here. I would choose to be here than anywhere else. I have to talk with you because I'm on an assignment. You may never see me again preach to you like this or talk to you like this because you don't owe me a thing. But I owe you everything. I owe you everything. And I must talk to you because you are bigger than you think. And you need to get engaged to move on. I pray that you prosper in dimensions you have never imagined before. Because where we are going now, we can't do it with a sickle. No, we need combine harvesters to do it. And we got to do it faster. So God's going to give you wisdom. Deuteronomy 8:18 must come true in your life. That it is God who gives us power to get wealth. Why? That he may establish his covenant. So they're, I saw Keith dancing in there. They have talents. Incredible talent. And that talent must go where it changes from just dance to real money. Money. Like money. See? And all that is possible. All that is designed and you need to walk in it. So now, how many minutes do I have? 10, good, great, now. So you've got three important things to follow, three important things. The first thing is you need to be clear on what you want. That's number one thing, clarity. You need to be very clear as to what it is that you want. Because people that know what they want usually get it. That's right. If you don't know what you want, then you just go. Then you just go. How do you know if you're right? Huh? How do you know if you're right? I mean, look, if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. So you do need to be clear about things. That's number one. Number two, you need to be focused. Focus is the power to say no to good things. You should be able to say yes to right things, not good things. There's a difference between good and right. Anybody running around with you to give you some good stuff every time? No, turn it down. Sugar is good. But it's not right for me. So I pass sugar when I see it. As sweet as it is. Pass. Pass. They are right things. It's people that understand right things that are going somewhere. If you're just going somewhere because of good stuff, you won't make it. You won't believe it. Believe me, you won't make it. You won't. You want. And the last part is what I like. See? Execution. So you have clarity, you have focus, now you execute. Execution requires structure. You gotta have structure. Without structure, you cannot execute. keeps you within boundaries of preserving strength. You need to understand that your brain and your body, they both get energy from the same source. That's why you can be very, very tired without doing any job but just thinking. I've seen people that are all forever depressed. I'm just so heartful. What's happening? I'm depressed. I feel like committing suicide. I don't see my reason of being on earth. I did this and this and then I gave so and so and look how they treat me. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Who do you think you are? Now if you come to me, the first thing I'll tell you, repent. That's if I like you, you should have been dead already. You are taking oxygen, you are taking space for somebody who can possibly use it the right way. The richest place on earth is the graveyard. Did you know that? Yeah. The graveyard is the richest place on earth. In the graveyard, skyscrapers have been buried there that were never built. Books are in the graveyard that were never written. Great things, inventions are lying in graveyards that were never done. So the graveyard is the richest place ever. It is the most orderly place I know. All graves are all in line. And nobody disturbs anybody over there. They are all busy lying. Waiting and waiting and waiting. That's right. And over there in the graveyard, everything is silent. Silent. Those of you that think I'm loud, there's a place called graveyard. There they don't make a... On the other word, there's another place as well. It's called maternity wards, where people are born. Those ladies at 9 months go into that place. And when they go, they don't care who is here. And they will be screaming. And then the little child, when she comes, when life comes, there's got to be some kind of noise going on. You are too sedated. Life is not waiting for you. Life is moving every day. For the politician, for the businessman, for the poor man, for the old person, every... Tick, 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 tick. All of us are the same. Whether we put you in the hero's echo or in the nobody's echo, you are gone. And none of us go beyond the tick, tick. None of us. Time is a currency. You spend it like money. It's moving. Money is a currency. It doesn't stay in one place, it keeps on moving. Now, because I love you, I'm going to give you a bonus. I know a lot of you want to have money. But maybe nobody told you this, so I'm going to tell you this, you know. Money has feelings. Money is feelings. Now, if you abuse money, it goes away. Now, you don't have to tell me if you abuse money. I just want to see your wallet and how the money inside there looks like. If it's been folded and folded and folded, I know that money is in serious abuse. That's right. That money is experiencing very, very, very hard time. Woo. So, here's another thing. Because I can't leave you poor, so I need to talk to you. Wow. committed crimes today. But I can't live without, I've got to tell you guys. So money is feelings. And if you abuse it, it goes away. Since money is feelings, it has to know that we are welcomed here. By you. But lately your behavior doesn't look like it's welcomed. Because whenever it arrives, it has a job, it's already gone. It already goes to buy something, immediately it passes. Did you know, on Earth yet, the Jews are at the top. The Jews' money circulate 13 times in their community before it leaves. And then after the Jews comes the Indians, 11 times before it leaves. Blacks, we don't show up. We are not only on the list because money just passes straight from we get it, we give it back to the white man or to the Indian or somebody. But we don't circulate it among blacks. We don't know how to do that. When it comes to money, we were told. This is why anytime you make money and a white man is close to you, it's almost like he's trying to say, give it to me. You don't need to have all that money. So we are conditioned that when money comes, it must go. So it goes. Abuse of money. Abuse. So I need to give you the medication for that now. Medication. All of us here needs to be, because you are all sick in money. So I need to give you the medicine for that. Here's what you do. In Zim, you are using US dollars. Right? The other one is bond, so we're not so sure about that one. But the real money, I'm talking real money now, right? Because you need to have real money. So. I don't know. Glory to God. Now, here's what you do. In the United States currency, the biggest bill of the land is a $100 bill. $100 bill. Right? Anyone in here with a $100 bill? Anybody?
Two words.
I mean, $100 bill? See now. This is what I was trying to say.
Second of that.
This is what I'm telling you. We need some inoculation quickly. We need to do some curing immediately. You need medication. You see? Yeah, so you're all sick. So we need to talk about it. Yes. I know you're going, the guy's crazy. You're right. So what you do is from today, your assignment is go look for a $100 bill. That's your number one assignment. Look for it. A $100 bill. When you get your $100 bill, here's what you do. You get your wallet, you open it. You make sure that that bill lies nicely in your wallet. No abuses. Let it just lie in there. Right? Somewhere. When you put it in that wallet, then you go to step number three. You delete it from your brain. Delete. It does not exist anymore. It has a job. Its job is, when I ask you, can I please have some money? You say, I don't have. Because now, your zero is 100. That's your zero. So when you say to some, it doesn't matter what the emergency was that people came with. No fuel, no one. You are zero, zero. Zero. At 100, you are zero. Zero. Completely zero. You have nothing to give anybody. You will walk on foot from here to Israel. On foot with 100 in your pocket. Don't touch it. It is a job. Don't touch it. You are being treated for being broke. And being broke is a bad thing. You should hate poverty. snake. Huh? That's right. So, what do you do then? You've got that hundred in there. What its job is to welcome smaller bills. So, when a $50 arrives in a pocket where there is a $100, the $50 checks and looks and sees a $100, and the $50 say, "How long have you been here, sir?" He says, "Oh, this is now my third month." "Oh, so this is a good place to stay." That's right. So the $50 stays comfortably next to the big guy. Safe. And when the 20 shows up, this line up, guys, here we stay. And he's just there. And before you know it, you have a wallet that's got something in it every time. Now, 2 months passes by. You're now fed up of being 0 at 100. You look for another 100 bill. You make them lie side by side. Now you are $200 zero. Now, let me tell you what happened. The more those hundreds are lying in there, you change the way you walk. Because now you know there may be problems in Zim, but I'm not one of them. Because right now, I do happen to have 600 US in my pocket that I don't need. And that's not a poor man's mentality anymore. At that moment, you are changing things about life. See? Look, money loves those that love it. Now, if you can be disciplined and you get to 1,000, a miracle happens. And here's the miracle. Money has a thing that's called pulling power. Pulling power. The pulling power of $1,000 that you don't need is amazing. You're going to meet someone who owed you $300. And all of a sudden, you know, I've been thinking, I need to pay you. And then they're counting 100, 200, 300. Thank you very much for helping me. And he goes away. You know what? And you tried to look for this guy forever, and they were not coming up. But the pulling power of the 1,000 makes people begin to pay you up, because the 1,000 is calling everything you are owed, and it's saying, "Come on, oh come, it's safe. We here, we've never been touched." So now I'm gonna give you my secret, all right? My secret about money. The purpose of money is let it lay eggs before it leaves. You got that? Money must lay eggs before it leaves. Don't use money the way it came. It must lay eggs. That means, now, I know a lot of people will be offended with this, but I'm going to tell you, poor people, when they get money, they pay bills immediately. Then they are back to zero. That's poor. When you rich people, when they get money, they pay themselves first. Then they pay everybody else whatever is left. So you need to sit down, and then you know, you owe about $900 to people. But your salary was $1,200. So you paid yourself 10% of that, and then you paid other things. So you're now left with 600 to pay. So you call everybody. You say, I won't be able to do the whole amount, but I'm going to send you this much. And you split it up among them. Nobody's going to hate you if they receive some. You make some kind of payment. No? No? Just let them pay them what you can. Because it's wrong for you to pay everybody and you stay with zero afterwards. Don't do that. They can be in zero, it's okay. But not you. You gotta have something to keep that's yours. And you hold on to it and believe that I'm gonna grow this money. And I'm gonna grow this money. Now, you're all very young here. And I'm gonna say one more statement and I'll release it. All of you listen to television and they tell you, you need to have an insurance. Buy insurance. That's what they tell us. At 50 years old, or 60 like me, you will get a million subsidy. Now, that's what we call brainwashing people. The insurance might not like me from tonight, but it's fine. Why should you take 50 years to make a million? Why? Why should you wait for 50 years to make 1 million? Why? Because the insurance told you to do that? For here I need an excuse. Hell no! No, 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 no. You should be making a million right now! As young as you are, by 30 something years you should be quitting your job because you don't need to wait for anybody else by that time. But oh no, 20, 30 years paying whatever insurance, when you pay them then they give you a million after 50 years. Hell no, you're not going to do that anymore. You are going to learn to keep your money for yourself and create your million by yourself. Whatever they are doing, you can do it as well.
For these and other stories, visit our website www.263chat.com. Follow us on Twitter @263chat and like our Facebook page, 263chat.